No.
Okay. Tim Cato, start us off.
Hey, Rick, I don't know if you saw this quote, but after game two, Kristaps talked about being a decoy. Actually, I have it in front of me. And just like how the offensive end, when, even when he's not getting the ball, how that creates shots for those around him. I'm sure it's all stuff that you've talked to him plenty about over the season, but I just wanted to see, you know, kind of what those conversations you are having with Kristaps and just his role and his importance, even if the ball isn't being funneled through him every possession or even not much at all.
So what's the question?
Your conversations with Porzingis about him being a decoy, a word he used, and just being someone who the ball doesn't always have to flow through, and how he's still effective to the team in those situations.
Yeah, I've never used the term decoy. That's his term. You know, he's one of the greatest spacers in the history of the game. He's historically great shooting outside the arc. He's a great corner three-point shooter. He's a 7'3 guy that you got to guard anywhere on the court. So, you know, that's a great advantage, you know, in the spacing game. That was one of the main reasons we set a record offensively last year. Now, that record's been broken by, I guess, Brooklyn probably this year. But, look, KP's a basketball player. He has diverse skills. He shoots the ball great. He's effective in the paint. But he's also a great roller. He's a great cutter. He can catch and shoot. He's a great runner. And he can involve himself in the game by crashing as well. And so, you know, the challenge in the playoffs is that it's difficult to run plays. You know, it's difficult to, I mean, the Clippers are into us so much defensively. They're denying everything. And so, you know, we've got to play out of the flow dimension as much as possible. Otherwise, it's hard for us to get shots. So, you know, he's finding ways to be involved and to get shots and to help create shots for others. And get to the free throw line. And, you know, I think game two was a great example. We had 20 points, had a highly efficient game, and, you know, we were able to win the game. And so in a playoff series, you know, sometimes it takes a level of resourcefulness, you know, to figure out different ways to positively impact the game, and he really did that well in game two.
Brad Townsend.
Yeah, hi Rick. Brad Townsend, Dallas Morning News. Tomorrow's atmosphere will be unlike anything you guys have experienced this year. I wondered if there's an effective way to, I don't want to say harness, but I mean channel that the crowd energy in a constructive way.
Yeah, you know, we talked about it a little bit today. We've got to maintain a road focus, is what I'm calling it. You know, this team's been very good on the road the last couple of years, and we've got to take that same kind of focus and attention to detail into our home building. You know, all the energy and you know, all the noise, et cetera, is something we've got to use to our advantage to help us focus even more. And, you know, I'm looking forward to it. I mean, I know our guys are looking forward to it, but just because you're home doesn't mean you're just going to walk out there and win a game. I mean, you've still got to keep doing the things that you've been doing well in previous games. And that's going to always be the challenge as you move along to the next game of a playoff series.
Mark Medina.
Hey, Rick, Mark Medina here, USA Today. Good to see you. How would you compare what Luke has done this season to his first years in terms of his play? How have you seen his leadership evolve this season in games and behind the scenes?
Yeah, he gets better all the time. Gets better each year, gets better week to week. You know, the leadership aspects are very evident as well. He's more involved in huddles, talking to teammates, talking about situations. You know, because he's getting so many different coverages and such unique attention, he's communicating all the time about, you know, where guys need to be, if there's double teams and things like that. It's a natural progression for a great young player to, you know, keep moving forward and developing all these skills, and some of which have nothing to do with actual basketball skill. Some of it's just communication. And communication, you know, when you're, you know, the best player on the team is, you know, a big part of being a great leader as well.
Eddie Sefko.
Eddie Sefko, Mavs.com. Rick, how mindful do you and your staff have to be of what's coming down the pike and what you expect the Clippers to do to change things up or whatever? Or is at this point in the series, is it more about making sure you're on point with what you know you're doing well and continuing to maybe even be better at what you do best?
I don't think there's any doubt that Game 3 will be the most difficult game that we faced all season because of the fact that we're up 2-0, and you know they're going to throw everything at us. It's going to be an even higher level of physicality to start the game. And we've just got to be ready. We've got to be ready. And this is one of the great things about playoff basketball. It's going to challenge you in every way possible. You know, it's going to challenge your your ability to focus. It's going to challenge your composure, your poise, your ability to maintain aggression and still play, you know, the game that we want to play. And so those are all great challenges. And as we've been saying, you know, from the very beginning of this, you know, we're looking forward to these challenges because this is how you grow, and this is what great competition is all about.
Okay, we'll do a couple more. Callie.
Callie Kaplan, Dallas Morning News. Rick, I'm curious, when it comes to free throw shooting, how in practice can you replicate, the pressure or the fatigue or just kind of the mental capacity that guys need to have when it comes to foul shooting in games? Is there anything that you can do to kind of practice that between games?
Yeah, there are ways to simulate it. We spent a pretty significant amount of practice today, you know, afterwards, getting a lot of free throws up, shooting a certain number at a time, you know, simulating a game routine, game situation, those things. it's an area where we can gain ground. We shot it pretty well in the first game. Second game, you know, it was 55%, something like that. And look, we're a better free throw shooting team than that. So we certainly see an opportunity to improve. And we are spending time on it, you know. Moving into tomorrow's game, it's been a point of emphasis, but you know, everybody's got to get comfortable. They've got to sort of, you know, reset their commitment to their routine, and we just got to move forward from there.
Okay, last question, Law.
Law Murray at The Athletic. Good to see you, Rick. I know going into the series, you praised Rajon Rondo despite what happened in Dallas 6 years ago. And even in game two, Rajon had a big impact on the game. And when he was off the floor, the Mavericks outscored the Clippers by 19 points. Have you been able to draw from your experience coaching him to prepare for what he's able to do to positively impact a team on the floor, and also to prepare for what the Clippers do when they don't have him on the floor?
Well, he's a great all-around player. He impacts the game in every way. In game one, You know, he made a bunch of threes and was a factor defensively and offensively. And, you know, he's a great communicator. I mean, he always knows what's going on with the other team. He's always calling out, you know, our plays and stuff like that. That's why we're trying not to run too many plays, because he knows them all. But he's a great competitor. You know, I really have great respect for everything he's accomplished in his career. Two championships with two different, you know, flagship franchises in the NBA. And I think he's going to be a great coach.
All right. Thank you, Coach.
Thanks.
Appreciate it. All right, guys. We will be in touch.